business as usual cannot continue. Our planet is already 1 degree Celsius hotter than a century ago. At our current rate of greenhouse gas emissions, we only have a decade before we risk catastrophic changes to our environment that will severely endanger our livelihoods. An equitable transition to a low-carbon economy is the only viable way forward. This transition is a major undertaking. It requires global cooperation and drastic changes to how we invest and consume. Not an easy task. But there is good news. If done right, the transition can unlock new sources of development and will spell sustainable, inclusive growth for the 21st century. I am Maksym Ivanyna. I'm economist at the IMF, and I'm here to tell you that well-thought-out policies can foster climate stability and simultaneously make our societies more prosperous and inclusive. So how can we prompt socioeconomic development while we adapt to inevitable climate changes and at the same time limit global warming to well below 2 degrees Celsius, as outlined in the Paris Agreement? We can do this through a host of policies. The essential most one is to price carbon. Introduce a carbon tax or a market where businesses can trade emission allowances. But governments can and should do more. First, they should invest in climate-friendly and resilient infrastructure. Renewable energy is vital, but so are nature-based solutions, like restoration of degraded lands and conservation of existing ecosystems. Second, government should provide incentives for private investment, innovation, and sustainable use of natural resources. Third, to inform our consumption and investment choices, governments should standardize and provide information about climate risks and ways to mitigate these risks. And finally, governments need to ensure that the transition to a low-carbon economy is equitable and fair. Let's look at some examples of how policies can be both climate-friendly and inclusive. The first is perhaps the most recognizable, the renewable energy sector, solar and wind. It not only offers zero-emission energy, it also creates more jobs than coal and oil. And whereas fossil fuel production is concentrated in few regions of a few countries, the ability to produce solar and wind energy is by contrast much more widespread, creating a more equal distribution of job and investment opportunities. Another example of climate-friendly inclusive policy is preservation of our natural environment, forests, wetlands, and other ecosystems. In many countries, these natural assets are very often de facto owned by low-income farmers. Governments can pay these farmers if they preserve nature on their land, a policy instrument called payments for ecosystem services. And as a result, the preserved nature provides both a global benefit and a livelihood for the underprivileged. Boosting climate-friendly investment also helps inclusion. Governments can boost the investment by lowering the risk for private investors and firms, a so-called de-risking. For example, governments can agree to buy electricity from a renewable energy power plant for a set price or to absorb a small portion of a potential loss, basically reducing the risk of return for those investors. Take the Lake Turkana wind power plant in Kenya, which supplies 17% of the country's electricity. While the cost of that power plant was roughly $800 million, it was fully paid for by private investors, with several de-risking incentives offered by the government and the international community. In addition to clean energy, the plant provides 300 local jobs and advances development of a poor and remote region by kickstarting necessary infrastructure projects, like road and electricity supplies. But not all policies are going to be integrally inclusive. Some will require government to make a deliberate effort to ensure that everyone benefits. For example, there is a lot of resistance to carbon tax reform, but the odds of its success greatly improve when governments take three steps: openly communicate and consult with stakeholders, implement the pricing in a gradual and predictable way, and efficiently spend the resulting tax revenue. The revenue can be used to help the poor to bear the brunt of energy price increase or to create job, investment, and training opportunities for the affected workers, businesses, and regions. Smart policy measures can also ease conflict which sometimes arises between local farmers and those protecting natural habitats. For example, in Zambia, the Community Markets for Conservation program does this by teaching alternative livelihood skills to former wildlife poachers and trains and supports local farmers living nearby national parks. Adaptation, investment in resilient infrastructure, can also be made more inclusive. Thailand's Ban Man Kong program provide subsidies to urban poor if they decide to upgrade their communities and make them more resilient to natural disasters. Restoring degraded land is another way to build resilience and at the same time help the environment and provide economic opportunities. On the southern edge of the Sahara Desert is the Great Green Wall, a multi-country community-led project. The initiative aids and trains farmers to plant drought-resistant trees and integrate them into crop and animal farming systems. The trees make farmers less vulnerable to heat, drought, and desertification. At the same time, the trees yield stable livelihoods and they absorb carbon and provide shelter for wildlife. These are just few of many inspiring projects from around the globe striving to preserve and restore our natural world. We learn more with each success. And the more we put into these efforts, the greater are our chances of creating a greener, more equitable, and prosperous future for everyone.